We're very pleased to have Ken Chang of the New York Times here this evening to introduce tonight's speaker.
Wow, this is like a full house on a Tuesday night. Wednesday. I just flew back from San Francisco, so I lost a day. And I guess it's probably not time for me to remember that I get stage fright in front of large crowds. But fortunately, I have the easy job of introducing a wonderful speaker. Steven Strogatz is the Jacob Gould Schurman Professor of Applied Mathematics at Cornell. His academic career started at the fine University of Princeton when he was undergrad there, graduated with a degree in math, summa cum laude. He then went to Cambridge as a Marshall Scholar and then got his doctorate from Harvard. He was a professor of math at the Massachusetts Institute of Technology from 1989 to 1994. And it was during these years at MIT that he received the Presidential Young Investigator Award from the National Science Foundation and MIT's Highest Teaching Award. And that was just the first of quite a few of teaching awards he's received. Then he moved to Cornell in 1994. And then in 1998, he and our former student Duncan Watts published this paper in Nature. And this is what brought him sort of wider recognition beyond academia. It's a really remarkable paper. They looked at this, what they described as small world networks. And this is what most people sort of understand as the 6 degrees of separation between you and any random person in the world. There's, you know someone who knows someone who knows someone who knows someone who knows almost anyone in the world. And what they showed was that this isn't because everyone has this wide network that everyone knows everyone everywhere, but rather there's a few people who are highly connected, and those sort of act like a nexus that connect people across different places. And this is something that isn't just true for, you know, the 6 degrees of freedom, but separation, but also for things like all kinds of networks like the power grid, the internet, airline route maps, and so on. And this was also like a nice piece of math that you could describe without mathematics. So lots of science writers, including me, wrote about it. A lot of people read about this in the newspaper. And it wasn't just popular among popular science people. This is also a highly influential paper in his field. And I know this because I read it on Wikipedia. In the decade after it was published, it was the number 6 cited paper in physics. So that's quite remarkable. Not just being satisfied being a highly successful professor and mathematician, he started writing popular science books as well. His books include Sync, The Calculus of Friendship, and one that was just published called The Joy of X. and he's also written what seemed to be an odd place for a science column, which it's in the opinion section of New York Times on the web. And I just wanted to highlight this for a moment and explain how he's made my life more difficult. So I'm a science writer. I write about a whole bunch of topics, and once in a while I get to write about science. And you know, once in a while about math. So once in a while on science too. When you're at the New York Times, your readers sometimes want to suggest what you should be writing about. And so there was a professor at the University of California, Davis, who likes to nudge me that I should be writing more math stories. And I usually have my excuses. No, my editors are math phobes. It's very hard to write math in a way that you can really bring along a non-mathematician and understand what's going on. And you know, I'm very busy too. Needless to say, this math professor wasn't exactly convinced by my excuses. So, and then he pointed, of course, to Dr. Strogatz's columns, and this is what he wrote. Let me add, by the way, that the columns by Steven Strogatz on mathematics have been just great. He conveys exactly the right spirit that mathematics is useful, but is even more interesting for its own sake. he shows the basic dilemma of mathematics journalism, that mathematics that was done decades or centuries ago is still exciting and newsworthy to lay readers, while many things done this year are arcane in comparison. Strogatz is not just great, but also popular. He would be a fine contributor or guiding light for recent developments in mathematics. And of course, this professor is absolutely right. So let's welcome Dr. Strogatz to Math Encounters.
Thank you. Wow, thank you, Ken. I'm sorry I made your life a little harder. That's really a very nice, warm introduction, and thanks. I can't believe all of you would come out. It's wonderful to see you here. And thanks very much to the Math Museum for having me and Simons Foundation for supporting this. Well, I would like to begin by talking about what Ken just mentioned, which is that I did have this odd opportunity to write about math for the New York Times in the opinion section, which is sort of an odd thing when you think about it. What is there? There's not much room for opinion when it comes to the right answer, certainly, in math. That's one of the things we like best about it. but so let me begin, I suppose, by telling you a little bit of the genesis of this strange invitation. I got to know the op-ed page editor, David Shipley, some years earlier when I wrote my first book for the public, Sync. I had written some op-eds around that time to try to help promote the book. And so we got to know each other. And so a few years after that, he surprised me by saying, would you ever have time to write a series for us about math? And I really couldn't imagine what he meant. I know that in the op-ed page, it's supposed to be topical, like you have to write about the news. Whatever it is, you must have noticed this when you read the opinion page. People always relate it to something in the news. So I said, you mean like I'm going to write about math related to climate change or the controversy about how to do the census? He said, no, not talking about that. I think you should start with numbers. What are numbers? Then do addition. Then do subtraction. And as I listened to him walk through the curriculum, and then you do algebra. I know the curriculum, I know. So, I thought, this is really a dream come true, because this is what every pedantic math professor would think of doing. Of course, we like that way of doing things. Very logical, you start at the beginning. But I said, are you sure you really want that? Because it's going to be, readers have already gone through that once. And we know how many people like math. The outcome isn't that great in general. He said, no, that's exactly my point. I want you to do that and make it interesting this time. And show us what we missed. So then he went on to tell me this sad story, which all of you who are either math teachers or math professors or just people who like math, you've heard this story when you talk to your friends who don't like math, that they hear you do like math, and then they go into something, oh, gee, I had this horrible algebra teacher who traumatized me, or once I got to long division, I was in trouble, or something like that. Everybody has a story. And so David Shipley starts telling me his story, which is that he actually could do math all the way through high school. He even took calculus, and he would get A's in everything. But he said he never knew what he was doing. He could get the right answer, but he never saw the point of it, never knew why he was doing anything. Couldn't I write something like that for his readers? That was his point, that he felt like lots of readers of the New York Times might have been good students, but had no concept of what math was about. And he also said, I hear people saying that math is beautiful, and I really don't have any idea what that means. Why? What's beautiful about this? Or then they use this fancy word, elegant. They'll say, math is so elegant. And he said, could you try to help us see what does that mean? What's elegant about math? So that's what I was trying to do, and that's what I guess I want to show you a little bit of tonight, although I think because this audience, I'm guessing, is either currently sophisticated about math or on the track to becoming sophisticated about math. I guess I want you to think of this as, it's not nice to say it like this, but sort of think of it as an us versus them situation. I'm presuming most of us are us here, I could actually check that with you. We could take the scientific approach. If you think of yourself as a math type, would you put your hand up? Okay, so that wasn't the right way to ask the question. What if I ask it the other way? So if you feel like you might be a little math phobic or not so comfortable with math? Would you? Okay, thank you for being brave and putting up your hand. So there are some brave people who have come here. I'm not sure why, but we appreciate you being here. And anyway, so I am going to kind of take the point of view that this is, in a way, more of a math communication talk than a math talk per se. How do you approach the, well, it is a problem. I mean, normally you're not supposed to say problem anymore. You have to say challenge. How would you approach the, how would you approach the challenge of conveying the beauty and elegance of math to people who have never understood that their whole life? And I mean this not as a rhetorical question. I mean it as a genuine question, because I don't know the answer to this. I know what I tried, and I know places where I had some evidence of success, and also others where I had some evidence of failure. And so I want to tell you what seems to be the lessons from what I did, what worked and what didn't work. Also, it seems very relevant to the Math Museum. Take notes. Because this is, of course, the issue for the Math Museum, too, is how to communicate math to the public and the pleasure of math. So let me begin by trying to enlist your help here. I would like this to be interactive, if possible. There are microphones. At the end, you can ask questions by standing at the microphones. But I'm going to ask you some questions throughout the talk, and I would appreciate it if you try to answer. And then we'll discuss those things. And I'll repeat your question so everyone can hear. So the first question would be this. Okay, suppose you're in this position that I was in, and David Shipley has just asked you to do this, and you've agreed to write 15 pieces, one a week, op-ed length, maybe 1,000 words, 1,500 words. What should be, and he already told you the structure, what he, you know, the editor is the boss. It's going to be numbers and walk through the curriculum, but still, what should be emphasized? What are some possible things that you would build the series around? I see you're already answering the question before I even finish asking it. That's a good sign. Go ahead, please, tell us. So the comment is that math is a subject that fits together in a way that all makes sense, so that when you learn one thing, that makes sense, and then you don't have to really unlearn it. The next thing will make sense and follow from that. And so would your point be that to try to bring out that nature of math, that kind of building block character of it? So the logical structure of math could be one theme. Other thoughts? Yes?
There have been some fantastic women mathematicians.
Fantastic women mathematicians who should be brought to prominence in the public eye, first of all, to inspire people of both genders, possibly to serve as role models, possibly because in the way that the history of math is usually told, they don't get the attention they deserve. And maybe could I generalize your idea to say that people like stories about people. And so stories of great mathematicians, men and women, would be inspiring to people. So make it a human story. That could be one other possible way of doing it. Yes? The world would fall into chaos without math. Yes. But so let's see. A way of saying that might be that our lives depend on math in all sorts of ways. And so the utility of math, and maybe more than the utility, the absolute necessity of math, which people don't realize that, you know, when they're on their cell phone or they're in an airplane or they're walking up the stairs to this room, that all of those things used math to make. So okay, yeah, let me take one or two other thoughts. Yes?
Elegant proofs lead to elegant mathematics.
Elegant proofs lead to elegant mathematics.
The lack of proofs lead to getting things wrong.
The lack of proofs lead to getting things wrong. But so is your idea that the series should be centered around the ideas of proof, which is for many people the key of the thing that defines math more, that makes it different from any other subject. And so the primacy of proofs and the elegance of proofs? Okay, and let me, all right, you're waving, so you got my attention. Okay, two guys right in line. You could both go, all right, but go ahead. Gentleman in front first.
The loss?
Loss of certainty. Ooh, well, this is a deep point. That is, everybody normally thinks of math as certain, and your point is that actually, even within math, there are uncertain aspects. Are you talking about like deep results in logic, for instance, Gödel's theorem and so on. Yes, yes. So there's been there are things in the history of math where bedrock ideas like Euclid's parallel postulate was later realized to be replaceable by other postulates that could lead to equally good geometries. I wish, where were you guys when I needed you? All right, I don't want to go on too long. This is fun, but we could. Oh, please. All right, you're the last voice here.
The last one would be probably why he was asking you to write it in the first place. The phobia of math was so scary.
Yeah, so this gentleman raises the point that, Shipley was asking me in the first place to do it because he sensed either that there's a phobia in the public or an aversion or some kind of negative feeling about math. And how did it get like that? How do we get ourselves in this situation, and what can we do about it? So these are all kinds of things that I had in mind. And in the end, I felt like I had to make a choice, which was the choice that I wanted it to be about the great ideas of math. That is, that's the key word, ideas. That there are beautiful ideas in math, and if I can show the ideas as distinct from the apparatus of math. That is, there's, like in school, you learn a lot of procedures. This is how you do long division. This is how you factor a polynomial. And a lot of us think of math as procedural. When you see this problem, you do this thing. Really, it's like that. A lot of people have a kind of spinal cord reflex that math appeals to their lowest part of their mind. And that's not right. Math should be appealing to the highest part of their mind, their aesthetic and creative part, as well as their logical part. So I wanted to strip out a lot of these distractions to get to the essence of math, which I think is the great ideas. And the second thing I felt like I had to do is, this is not just gonna be you going to an art gallery and there's a guide who says this is a pretty painting or the mathematical equivalent. It has to be that I want it to be more like you're a jazz musician on stage feeling what it's like to be a musician. Or in this case, you're gonna do math and feel an aha moment, or feel the shiver of pleasure that comes from insight, which is why people who do math, I mean, that's one reason we love it, is that it's very pleasurable to be confused and then suddenly not confused. That's fun. And so a lot of people never had that. They just were confused the whole time. And so I want them to have moments every week of suddenly understanding something, and it could be small. That doesn't matter how big or deep it is, just some. So, okay, so let me begin, as the editor suggested, with preschool. And so the first column was this one, called From Fish to Infinity, and it, by the way, so Ken mentioned that this was on the web. At first I thought that this is second-rate real estate, that it would be better to be in print, it's more prestigious, and I eventually came to realize that no, actually, it's good to be on the web because you can show movies, you can show computer simulations, you can show color diagrams. There's not really much of a space limit. Nobody cares how long you go on the web. So here's the beginning. And I just want to read a little bit to you, although I'm not going to be reading much, but just because I think there's another whole aspect of this, which is not just math. There's writing involved, and communication of math in print involves the written word. So as you'll see, I ran into trouble in the first sentence. You may not be able to read it in the back, so let me read it to you. It says, I have a friend who gets a tremendous kick out of science, even though he's an artist. Do you see the problem with that sentence? What's wrong with that? Or possibly objectionable in that? Yeah, what's the even though? Yeah, what's that? Well, okay, so there's a presumption in the even though that an artist would not necessarily, or you might not expect an artist to like science, and here's one that does. So, all right, let's suppose we're not trying to be negative about artists, and I'm not. I do actually think it's a little surprising, honestly. Maybe it's a prejudice. I do think, I did say what I meant, that I do think it's intriguing that an artist would be in love with science, but over the two or three years since then, I've thought about wordsmithing this. What else could we say? Rewrite that sentence nicer. You want to make a suggestion? I have an artist friend who gets a tremendous kick out of science, period. Could say it that way. Excuse me? Yes. Art and music are very connected to science. So there's really no inherent contradiction. It should be straightened out somehow. You could say I have an artist friend who gets a tremendous kick out of science. Another person once, when I asked this question, said, make it two sentences. I have a friend who's an artist, period. He gets a tremendous kick out of science, period. That's sort of an interesting way to do it because of the non sequitur. I mean, a person might think, what? But actually, that's the point, that it is not a, it's not a non sequitur. Anyway.
But I think that the way you have it addresses the issue that you're trying to address.
That's right. The way I have it does address the issue, which is that we think, this is why I don't completely regret it, that we think there's two cultures, even though there aren't. People who know really know there aren't, that there's a creative, okay. But leaving that aside, the prejudice is that there's the art world, the word of worlds and beautiful things, and there's the numbers world, and they're separate and so, but I'm trying to say this person is both. Okay, so I have a friend who gets a tremendous kick out of science, even though he's an artist. Whenever we get together, all he wants to do is chat about the latest thing in evolution or quantum mechanics. But when it comes to math, he feels at sea and it saddens him. The strange symbols keep him out. He says he doesn't even know how to pronounce them. So, you know, like if there's that thing that we call the integral sign that looks like the F hole on a violin. He reads that, he doesn't know how to, what do I say? I don't know what to say when I read that. He doesn't know what to say, the integral of. And apparently that makes it hard to look at math if you don't know how to read it in your head. In fact, his alienation runs a lot deeper. He's not sure what mathematicians do all day. Okay, no jokes there. Or what they mean when they say a proof is elegant. Sometimes we joke that I should just sit him down and teach him everything, starting with 1 + 1 = 2 and going as far as we can. Crazy as it sounds, over the next several weeks, I'm going to try to do something close to that. I'll be writing about the elements of math from preschool to grad school. For anyone out there who'd like to have a second chance at the subject, but this time from an adult perspective. It's not intended to be remedial. The goal is to give you a better feeling for what math is all about and why it's so enthralling to those who get it. So I felt like at least now the readers know what I'm trying to do. I'm not going to teach them the math they didn't learn the first time. I'm going to try to teach them why math is enthralling. What is it that people love who love math? So let's, now, by the way, I wasn't clear whether people would, whether this would work. And the reaction to this first column was immediate. It got over 500 comments. I mean, here as current, it's 547 comments. That's a big reaction. And I won't go down to the comments, but if you look, and you can see them online, the overriding reaction is people are saying thank you. Thank you to the New York Times for doing this. Thank you to Professor Strogatz for doing it. So it was really gratifying, especially compared to the normal publishing life of a professor. usually we write papers and you're lucky if 3 or 4 colleagues admit that they read it and they will never comment on it. It's really kind of bleak for the most part. Not always, but to have this many people all excited was really fun and unusual. All right, so anyway, let's begin with preschool. So there is Ernie, but from Sesame Street, and I knew about this clip because my kids, who are now 10 and 12, we used to watch this Sesame Street video, which you can find on VHS, I guess, if you can, well, maybe it's on DVD now, I hope. 1, 2, 3, count with me, really good. And so I thought this was the best introduction I had ever heard about why numbers are interesting and useful. Look at that, technology, there it goes.
The phone.
I'll get it. Man, ow.
Oh, hold on. It's for you, Humphrey.
Mm-hmm. Here you go. Thank you. Yellow, furry arms, how may I help you?
We're hungry.
Well, what would you like?
A fish.
Fish?
A fish.
Fish?
Fish.
Fish?
How about you guys?
Fish.
Fish, fish. You got it?
Let me repeat that. Fish, 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 fish.
You got it!
All righty, be right up with that order, Mr. Penguin, sir.
Yum.
Ingrid, go tell the kitchen, fish, 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 fish.
Fish, 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 fish.
Fish, 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 fish.
Not that easy in order, but I'll get it.
Ingrid and Humphrey, I have a better way for you to do this.
A better way?
Mm-hmm.
What do you mean?
Well, I just think it would be easier if you, count the fish.
Count them?
Really?
Mm-hmm. Look, I'll show you. Humphrey, you tell me the order, and I'll count with you.
Alrighty. Fish.
One.
Fish.
Two.
Fish.
Three.
Fish.
Four.
Fish.
Five.
Fish.
Six. See there? See what I tell you? Now you know how many fish to send up. Six fish.
Holy mackerel! This counting thing can really save a person a lot of trouble.
Yeah, yeah. Does it work on other stuff? Say, cinnamon rolls?
Yep.
Cream pies?
Sure.
Spark plugs?
Absolutely.
Wow!
Wow! He did it again!
He may be the smartest person in the whole world. Mm-hmm. All right, Ingrid, let's go get those... What are they again?
Fish!
Fish! Ha-ha!
Oh, Sheriff! We need six! Count six fish!
Yeah, good. So I like your reaction to that, because you really... got it. In a way, actually, a lot of audiences don't laugh at the place where you laugh the hardest. It's interesting. So the lesson, there are two lessons there. And the first lesson is when Ingrid says, these numbers can save a person a lot of trouble, right? They can save a person a lot of trouble, first of all, because it's a shortcut to just say six instead of fish, 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 fish. So there's that. It's also more resistant to error, right? You hear that when Humphrey says fish, 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 fish. She repeats it and only says it five times. So it's easier to make a mistake, but six is a sort of better in terms of that. So it's an improvement to have the concept of six first, because it's a shortcut. Second, it's more resistant to error. And then third is the thing that you guys laughed at. You remember what the third big point was?
Does it work
on other stuff? And she says cinnamon rolls, spark plugs. Well, but you see, that is exactly the point of what numbers are all about, that numbers are an abstraction. Now, you don't think about that because you're so comfortable with numbers that you think it's not six is not abstract. Six is very basic and childish. Well, at one time in your life, six was hard for you. And the reason is that six is more abstract than six fish, right? I mean, six does not live in the world. Six fish lives in the world. Can rot and smell, you know, and you can eat six fish. You can't eat six. You can't touch six. Six is an abstraction that lives in the world of transcendent ideas, like where truth and justice and goodness live. It's a Platonic, I'm serious. Numbers are abstract in the way that Platonic philosophy is abstract. Now, a little kid, you know, doesn't think about that, but I remember I'm writing for adults here. So what makes numbers great is that they're an abstraction that can apply to six cinnamon rolls and six spark plugs and six fish, and they're the thing that they have in common. They have nothing else in common materially. What they have in common is their numberosity or something. So, okay, it's too obvious, and I always find people get confused on this point because it's so familiar. Like, they think, what are you talking about? Why are you going on about that? But it's because numbers are the first abstraction in math, and they illustrate a theme, which is that abstraction gives you power. You always hear people saying, I mean, I do, and I'm sure you teachers hear it all the time, oh, what I don't like about math is it's so abstract. You know, I can't picture it, or it's not concrete enough. Well, that's right. That's what makes it difficult, but that's also what makes it powerful, because six can apply to anything. And so throughout math, we introduce abstractions not just to punish people. Well, it's useful for that, too, but really for the power it gives us to generalize and unify. So you start to see that with this little example, and so the rest of the column goes on to talk about this philosophical point about what numbers really mean and where do they live philosophically and so on. But let me move on from that to try to give an example of when I said I want people to have an aha moment. Here comes an example of what I mean by that. And then I want us to do an exercise together, because we have a workshop here. So that will come second as another example of aha moments, and also to illustrate the idea of elegance, that an elegant proof is one that doesn't just convince you of something, but actually illuminates. That is, it shows you why something is true, and ideally it's surprising and pleasurable. So what we're going to do now is try to understand what mathematicians mean by elegance by having you feel it. All right. So anyway, we don't know who the author is, but it's one of the great arguments in the history of math. And it has to do with something that you all learned in school, if you're high school age, if you're younger, maybe you haven't learned this yet, but it's about the area of a circle. And so in high school, kids memorized this formula: the area of a circle is pi r squared. So let me remind you what that means. I don't mean to insult people who totally have this under their belt and they know everything. This is for the other, like, three people here. No, or just to remind you also. So pi, first of all, try to remember what pi means. So you have a circle and it has a circumference. That's the distance all the way around. And then there's the diameter, which is the distance across going through the middle. And it's obviously longer to go all the way around than to go across. And if you take the ratio of those two numbers, or those two distances, circumference divided by diameter, that's what we call pi. And you probably at some point memorized some digits, maybe you know 3.14159, et cetera, depending how much you like to memorize. And then if you're really sharp, you're thinking, well, how do I know it's the same for all circles, big and small? Very interesting point. Let's not go there right now. I want to do other things. But yes, that's something you have to think about. How do you know it actually doesn't depend on the size of the circle? But OK, let's suppose we've established that it's the same for all circles. So that's the definition of pi. Now, remember, about length, circumference divided by diameter. Now we're not going to talk about length anymore. We'll talk about area, which is the space inside the circle. And so there's this question of, what is the area of that circle? Now, this proof I want to show you, the pi r squared, pi is the pi we just talked about. R means the radius, which is now half the diameter, distance from the center out to the circle itself. And so what we're going to do is an argument that looks very unpromising at first. And I feel like it has a structure of drama. That is, often in drama, things get bad for the hero before they get good. Right? That's what makes it interesting. There's trouble. What is the saying? You put your actor up a tree or something, and then you got to find a way to get him down. So this is, we're putting this proof up the tree first, which is we take the circle, which is a very nice, perfect shape. And gee, we're trying to figure out what the area of that is. Let's chop it into four pieces and rearrange it to make this strange worm-looking shape at the bottom. And if we could only figure out what the area of that was, we would have solved our problem. Because they would have the same area. We just rearranged the four pieces. But that shape looks much worse. How can that be a good step? It seems like a bad step. But bear with me, because it's actually going to be a brilliant step. OK, so we make this funny shape. And I want you to notice two things about it. I didn't bring a laser pointer, but let's see. Well, let me point with both arms. No, that's not going to help. You see that there are curved parts where I've indicated it says pi r on the bottom. What I'm trying to say there is that those two curved parts have a length which is half the circumference, because the whole circumference is made of the four curved parts. Right? Just look at the circle on the top. It has four pieces. It has four curved parts. Put them together, that's the circumference. Two of them are on the bottom, and two are on the top of that weird shape at the scalloped shape on the bottom. So half the circumference, which we said the circumference is pi times the diameter, half of that would be pi times the diameter over 2. And diameter over 2 is radius. So pi r is the length of what's on the bottom. And r is the length of that tilted straight line on the side. All right, so at the moment, as I say, it doesn't look very good. But then comes the interesting thought, well, maybe we didn't make enough pieces. What if we made 8 pieces? And then rearrange them like that. Now, do you notice that the shape has gotten kind of improved on the bottom? Let's see what's better about it. So this is like at the eye doctor when they say, which is better, before or after? Before, I'll do that with you right now. Before, after, before, after. All right, so let's look at before. I mean, the thing on before is that the part that says R is tilted. Watch that it's not as tilted. It's more straight up. You see that? Also, notice that the bottom says pi r. It's half the circumference. The bottom still says pi r. It's still half the circumference. OK, now let's go to 16 pieces. Ah, yes. Notice that the r is starting to stand pretty straight up, and the bottom is getting flat. It's not so bumpy. And so now comes the amazing stroke that, why stop at 16? Why not keep going, 32, 64? In fact, why not take infinitely many, infinitesimally thin slices? So that's where everybody's head starts to melt a little bit. So if you don't want to think about infinity, you can just say, just keep doubling the number of slices. But you can, I think, believe that the bottom is going to get very flat and the side is going to stand straight up. And when it does, it's going to look like that. Okay? And now that's a shape we know how to find the area of. And it still has pi r on the bottom and r on the side, and you multiply them together, it's pi r squared. That's the area of a circle. Now, did you feel something? If you've never seen that argument, I mean, I'm actually feeling a little scalp tingling, literally. I could don't have so much hair left, but I could still feel tingling sensations. I'm not saying that for theatrical purposes. I really just felt it. And it's amazing that this can still do that after knowing this. We've done this proof a billion times. That's probably not really true. But I've done it many times. And it's a fantastic proof. It's like playing a great symphony. You could never get tired of this. It's a magnificent, it's one of the great arguments in the history of humanity. So I hope you can see that. And part of what I think is so shocking and fantastic about it is most people assume infinity is your enemy, that infinity is hard, infinity is confusing. But actually, little kids like infinity. They're not scared of infinity. You can go to any playground and hear arguments. Infinity is the biggest number. No, it's not. Infinity plus one is bigger. No, it's not. That's still infinity. Have you ever had that argument? Yeah, of course. Everyone loves infinity. Infinity is really interesting and fun. And actually, in math, infinity is tremendously powerful. Infinity is the key tool in calculus. That's what makes calculus different from every other part of math, is that you learn that infinity is like this wild horse that is hard to ride, but if you can tame it, it's the best thing you can use for, I mean, it will solve all your problems. So this is what makes calculus one of the great ideas of all time. And so what you just saw there is your first calculus argument. You saw a controlled use of infinity to answer a problem that you couldn't answer otherwise. You can't find the area of a circle without calculus. You need some argument like this, because a circle is round. Yes, it's round, we know that. But because it's round, it's hard to find its area. You can only easily find areas of things that have straight sides. And so we had to somehow convert this round shape to a straight-edged shape, which we just did, through the use of infinity. All right, so that was one example of an elegant, I hope, argument. I feel like at this point I want to thank my wife, who was my constant editor in these, and also my test. She's a person who is actually an artist, and she's not the person I was referring to, but but she is, she would read the articles before anyone else, and she would say, most of the time, that's boring. And then I would know I was on the wrong track. And she would say, there's nothing, I'm not getting any insight, I'm just doing math. Okay, so for her, math is not the goal. She doesn't want to do math. She wants insight. She wants some illumination. She'd always use the word. That's not illuminating. So this, she said, that's illuminating. I never understood about pi r squared. I never even thought about it. I just memorized it. Now I understand it. And it turns out the readers felt the same way. This one made it to number one most emailed in its week. People love this argument. And it's, to me, that's a lesson, because this is, you might say, math needs to be about stories about great people. That might help, but I don't even know what person came up with this. There are no people in this article. Or math should be about applications and how important it is in the real world. I love that stuff. I'm an applied mathematician, but this is not about the real world. This is just pure poetry. This is just a beautiful argument for the pleasure of tickling your mind. And people like it. So I think that's encouraging. Now here, speaking of mind tickling, let me show you one other, and then you can tickle your mind your own way with another proof. What we're gonna do next is the thing that you heard about in geometry called the Pythagorean theorem, if you've taken geometry. Or if not, here's a good chance to learn what it's all about. So it has to do with triangles shaped like this triangle that I'm showing here, the gray triangle. The question is, if you know the length of the sides where they meet at a right angle, so there's a side going straight up and then there's a side going horizontally, suppose we know their length, and their length is called A and B, what's the length of that sloping side, which people call the hypotenuse? And so that has a length C, and we're trying to find how does C relate to A and B. And a child's first thought, I mean, I know from my own children, they think it's C is equal to A plus B. That's what they would say. That is, that the length of the long side is you just, like if I said it's 3 on this side and 4 on that side, how long on that? My kids would either say, they would typically say 7, because they think if you just said 3 and 4, I'm supposed to add. What else would I do? So they say 7. And then you say, really? You think it's like that? So do you really think that if you walk, like certainly anyone who lives in this city knows that if you walk on this block and then you walk on that block, wouldn't it be faster to if you could cut through the building and go like that? It's not 3 plus 4. This is clearly shorter than 3 plus 4. Everyone actually knows that. So that's not the right answer. It's not 3 plus 4. It's something else. And well, right, so the correct result is you go what this picture says. You go 3 squared plus 4 squared. So that would be 9 plus 16, and that makes 25. And then you're supposed to take the square root. That's 5. So this is the famous 3, 4, 5 triangle. But the issue here is why? Why is that the rule? Why do you add the squares, not the numbers? And so here's this ancient diagram where you show the squares actually sitting on the legs of the triangle and on the hypotenuse. And the statement is that the area of the little square, which is area A squared, literally a square. Now this, by the way, for my wife was illuminating. This would not have occurred to me. That she said, I didn't know when you said A squared, you mean a real square, a physical square. She thought it's just A times A, which is one way to think of it. It's about multiplication. But it's also about a shape, that the area of, I mean, you know that if you're math people. But you got to realize other people don't know that, including she got A's in all her courses. She took calculus. She never understood that the area of a square, you get my point, that there's different ways of thinking about math. And a lot of times we're rushing, and kids don't get the most basic thing. So anyway, so the statement is that the area of that little square, A squared, plus the area of the middle square, B squared, if you add those areas together, it's the same as the area of the big square, C squared. Now, why is it true? So in a minute, you're going to demonstrate it for yourself with a paper cutout that's sitting on your seat. But I don't want to do that first. I want to show you two different proofs. Oh, geez, now I've got you activated and you're starting. Don't stop that. Don't look at what's on your lap. That's coming. My fault. I misled you, misdirection. Here's what I want to do. Two different proofs. And see if you think one proof is better than the other. Now that's a concept, again, a lot of people don't have. They think it's a proof. It's right or it's not right. What could be better if they're both, if you know what I mean? Some proofs are better, more convincing, more beautiful, more pleasurable than others. They could both be right. So here's one proof. Let's start like this. Here's the triangle. I put a square on it. That side had length C, so that area is C squared. Now, does that picture make you feel a little uncomfortable? Like, it does, in a way. It makes me feel uncomfortable because I think of it as a real square sitting on a tilt, and it looks like it wants to fall down or roll off. This is part of math, too, a kinesthetic feeling, a body feeling, that you should look at mathematical objects like they're real and think, I don't like that. That looks unstable. So let's make it more stable. I mean, you don't have to have that thought, but if you wonder, how does a proof happen? It's from intuitive feelings like this. We don't teach enough about intuition. We're so big on rigor. Ooh, math is where I learned to be rigorous. That's half of it. The real good part of math is the first part, the intuition part. And then the rigor part, to me, is mopping up. You need to do that, too, to be a professional. But the idea is the first part, is the creative part, the spark of genius. So here, we see this thing looks unstable. We don't like it. So we stabilize it by encasing it. It also looks a little asymmetrical. Like, why am I putting the square there? I mean, the square has four sides. I could put that triangle on any of its four sides. Why did I pick that side? Seems arbitrary. So if I go this way, now every side gets its own triangle. Okay, that's a more symmetrical picture. It looks prettier. So then when you look at that picture, to me, that starts to look like a child's puzzle. Like, I can picture those triangles as little puzzle pieces, like you're playing jigsaw puzzles. So now it looks like a real puzzle, okay, with a frame around it. So picture a wooden frame, and there's those little puzzle pieces. One of them has been pulled out. And so the C squared, I'm now thinking of as empty space. So this proof is going to be, in this, if it were art, it would be called negative space. Instead of thinking about an object, I'm going to think about what's missing, the space around the object. So here there's the four triangles, and then there's the space that's in the middle of the frame that's empty, called C squared. And now what I want to do is move those four puzzle pieces around and change the C squared into two squares that are A squared and B squared of empty space. You get it? That'll show that since I haven't changed the empty space, A squared plus B squared will be C squared. So watch, here we go. Move the four puzzle pieces around. Watch, we'll do the eye doctor thing again. Those four triangles, just move them around like this. They're the same triangles. And do you see I just made two squares? One that's A squared, the short side squared, and the other is B squared, the long side squared. Do you believe it? It fits rigidly in that frame, and that's it. I mean, that's the reason that empty space can be looked at two ways, as C squared or as A squared plus B squared. So that's one proof. This is an ancient proof due to the school of Pythagoras. We don't know if Pythagoras himself thought of it or if one of his disciples or what, but this is a really old argument, that 2,500 years old. Okay, now it's your turn. You've got a piece of paper with five shapes. They're different sizes. They're different shapes. Cut them out, and what you're going to do is try to rearrange them. Let's give, I don't know, Glenn, what do you think, like 10 minutes or something? Yeah, so take 10 minutes and just have fun and move the pieces around and try to make a big square and also two little squares. Oh, you can use your folder as a workspace. Use all five pieces, and you'll either make one big square or you'll make two smaller squares. But you will use all five pieces. Okay, so you've made one square. Now you have to rearrange that to make two other squares. And you got two squares, so you could teach each other. There's two squares, right. Now, so that's two squares. Now try to make it into one bigger square. Keep trying. You can make two, you make a medium and a small. You can make a big out of the same pieces. So you did one like that? It was pointed out I could take this on photo booth here on the Mac. Look, this shows that everybody can learn, okay? And I need to learn. Oh, Jesus.
All right, take it away, Steve.
3, 2, 1. Ah. Okay, well then I want to show the other way of looking at it. Back. Yeah, we're good. So this medium length one is B, and this is the B square. And then A is the medium. That's an A square. Can you see it says A backwards, or Leonardo da Vinci style mirror. And then there's a vertical one that also says A. So there's that one. Now that is putting all five together to make the big Mondo square, C squared. So there you have two proofs that A squared plus B squared equals C squared. Mine with negative space, not mine, Pythagoras's. And this one that the Math Museum will be making into an exhibit, which uses positive space. That is, it's using the pieces of the squares themselves rearranged rather than viewed as empty space. It's the space that's been reconfigured to make the two configurations, the squares, two squares or one square. So it's a little self-serving to put it this way. But I think the first proof is a much more beautiful and easy to understand proof. This proof, to me, is hard to find, and it's not clear to me why it works. But I don't know. There's an aesthetic taste here. I mean, this is a judgment call. This is not, now we're out of the domain of proof and into the domain of aesthetics or something. But what do you all think? Do you like, maybe you would say negative space is somehow negative. You don't like working with emptiness. You like working with stuff. So maybe you prefer this one, or maybe you find this one easy to understand. You're not saying anything. Yes?
The question is,
jumping from off from the point you made that you found the first proof more appealing, and in fact you didn't even feel that the second one actually proved it to you. What was there about it that was proof? Well, that's how I feel about a lot of proofs, and it seems to me that anybody who doesn't get the proof, as you just said, can that person say it's proven, or are they just taking it on faith?
It's such an interesting question. I know where you're coming from. When I do that second argument, and of course you all just had the experience of trying to rearrange those pieces to make two different squares or one square. Some of you had trouble even getting that to happen. But even if you could get it to happen, how do you know that those shapes are really squares? They look like squares. Do they really fit perfectly? Of course, that's part of the math. To make it a rigorous proof, and the same thing is true with my proof with the frame, I have to prove that, you know, everything really is a square, everything touches the way it looks like it touches. So in fact, by standards of the best modern math, neither of these would really be considered proofs without a lot more care. They are proofs. They can be made into proofs. And it's an interesting point that a proof is not something that, there's different concepts of proof. There's a proof that would satisfy a machine that is really a strictly logical proof, like they talk about formal proof theory, you know. And for certain applications, like in national security or for testing of atomic weapons or certain things like this, where it's really important you're not making a mistake, the government insists on certain very, very high, and plus mathematicians would want very high standards of proof, the best we can achieve, certifiably true proofs. Whereas these proofs that we're talking about today have to satisfy a human student or subject. And it's a little bit subjective, honestly, in practice. I don't know, that's a bit of a radical position to take, but I think that is the honest answer. And over the history of math, some proofs that were thought to be proof, like Euclid, you know, for a long time was thought, this is the gold standard of proof for thousands of years. But then in the late 1800s, people started to notice gaps in Euclid's arguments, that he would draw pictures of circles and he would assume that they crossed somewhere. But there was a continuity assumption that who says that they actually crossed? And he needed properties of the real numbers, which were not known at the time. Later great mathematician, Hilbert, had to introduce all the hidden axioms that Euclid didn't even realize he was assuming tacitly to make Euclid solve. So if Euclid's proofs weren't proofs, we have to sort of worry about everybody's proofs. And yet Euclid has convinced people from Abraham Lincoln to Thomas. I mean, a lot of smart people have believed Euclid because he's very convincing to a human being, to most human beings, except if you don't get what he's saying, then he's not convincing. I don't know, this is a tough question. There's a lot of a lot of hands in the air, so okay, go ahead.
There's this fantastic book that's called Proofs Without Words.
Oh, yes.
And the entire book is just, every single page is just a picture, and then at the bottom it tells you what the picture proves. And there are all these fantastic statements. There's this great picture. I think the easiest one that I could describe is one that shows a square, and every, if you like,
I can show you, I have that proof.
Oh, you have it there? Okay.
I have it. So for people who haven't looked at this series, you can find it on the Times by just searching Strogatz and New York Times. And then they have conveniently indexed these columns. There's 15. So the one you're referring to is right here under rock groups, where we're thinking of numbers as groups of rocks. And I'll let you take it from there with this picture, right? Okay, so the remark you want to make is this, that if we add the first few odd numbers consecutive, one
wow,
plus
we think alike.
Four, what? You've got the mic, go ahead, you take over.
Okay, so the idea is you want to say, well, the sum of the first odd numbers, first positive odd numbers, what do they add up to? And so in the column, what you see there, well, initially in the equations is 1 plus 3 is 4, 1 plus 3 plus 5 is 9, 1 plus 3 plus 5 plus 7, you get 16. And then you keep going, and you see the pattern. Someone before was talking about patterns. You see the pattern. Obviously, the sum is square numbers. So, I mean, that's immediately obvious, and you figure this can't just be an accident. So how do you go about proving it? You could try to work this out algebraically, and you could move symbols around. And someone, if you feel good about algebra, you might be convinced by that, or you might not be. But to me, anyone who looks at this picture and sort of thinks about what this picture represents, to me, you sort of look at this and you say, with the, in the top right corner, there's one black, and then you see, then there's three, the little next L is three whites, and then five, and then seven, and then nine. You can quickly convince yourself that these are consecutive odd numbers, and you can immediately convince yourself that this is a square number. So to me, this square proves it and also illuminates, as you said before, as quickly and as clearly, more so than anything algebraic possibly could. And yet, by sort of traditional mathematical standards, just this picture would not be considered a proof. And I think that a situation like this might actually beg the definition of where do we draw the line as to what is a proof and what is not. So without getting into that debate, you could say that also that there are proofs serve two different sorts of functions. One is to logically verify that something is true following axiomatic rules of inference. And that's sort of a more mathematically oriented definition of what a proof is. And one is more cognitively oriented, which is what we were talking about before, by this feeling of seeing something and saying, aha, I understand. So a proof that convinces.
It sounds like we agree that this is what defines elegance, is that it's, I mean, there are proofs, and then there are proofs that are, without a lot of pain, convince you and illuminate. I saw a lot of people had reactions to all kinds of things. So should we take these comments now? Why not?
The pictorial proofs, the physical proofs that you've shown, they go back to your other half that you were explaining, the intuitive half.
Yes.
The idea. And that is something that I think is greatly lacking in mathematical education, is that at some point, we let go of that and say, no, it's really the rigor that really defines math, whereas the original idea comes from that intuition. So even though it's not strictly a mathematical proof, but the idea is what somebody had in the first place. They saw this shape, and they decided, oh, this actually makes sense. And I think that the elegance and the aesthetics and all the beauty of math is really the sense, why does this even exist? Why does the picture even exist? You know, why is it that there is a proof, there is some axiomatic way of going, but why are we even able to visualize it? And when that clicks, and that's when you kind of see the beauty of math, to me at least.
Good, okay. Maybe I should take one more. I did have one other point I wanted to make before my clock runs out about what I regarded as a failure, or at least a lesson that I learned that you might find valuable if you're a teacher or a writer or an expositor of some kind, or even just trying to explain math or some other difficult subject to yourself. But so let me take one other comment, and then I'll try to show you what I take as that chastening lesson that I got from doing these calls.
Do you have the young Einstein's proof?
I know it. I don't have it handy to show.
Because he was so disturbed by this that none of these were proofs in his 13-year-old mind. They were demonstrations that it could be true, but his proof demonstrates that what's at stake here, or that this is an artifact of a larger concept, which is similar objects, the area of similar objects are proportional to the square of any linear distance, yes. So he drops a perpendicular and turns all the sides into hypotenuse. He's got three similar triangles, and it's boom, 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 boom.
Yeah, it's really hard to beat that proof.
And he's 13 years old.
He's 13 and he's Einstein.
Right.
Yeah, I should show that. I mean, if we were doing it, it would be interesting to have a little piece, maybe. It's a good idea for an article, sort of a comparison of, because, and you can find this on the web, certainly. There's a nice, at the blog called Cut the Knot. Cut the Knot, K-N-O-T, Cut the Knot. Cut the Knot has something like 70 or 80 assembled proofs of the Pythagorean theorem, including by President John Garfield. Is it John or James?
James,
excuse me. Not so good in history, doing too much math. James Garfield, they talk about, like, he could write in two different languages at the same time with two hands. He was a really good chess player. He was a really smart guy who they killed, somebody killed. And he has a proof of the Pythagorean theorem. But anyway, so Einstein has this really nice, one of the all-time best, maybe the best, along with this. So I guess your point is that Einstein had a certain reaction to the existing proofs and felt they're not quite getting at the essence yet, and this is what it's about, is what you mentioned. What doesn't work when you're trying to explain math to the public? So here's how I want you to think about this. Let's take that example of the cutting the circle and looking at the area of a circle by rearranging it. I would consider that very familiar material. Everybody went through high school, everyone heard pi r squared at some point. Familiar, yet abstract. That is, it's not about anything, you know, it's not like about a bridge or about food or something very palpable and tangible. It's just about an area of an abstract circle. So I found that you can get away with doing abstract things as long as they're familiar in the sense that people have gone through this at some point in their education and they're used to it, even if they don't understand it. They're happy to have it straightened out. So what I'm trying to get at here is there's two categories we can think about that have to do with difficulty, and there may be more categories. I'm sure there are more categories, but there's the abstract versus concrete axis, and then there's the familiar versus unfamiliar axis, okay? And so you can do abstract as long as it's familiar, as in that example, or you can do something that's very unfamiliar if it's sufficiently concrete. Like I had one column that was about O.J. Simpson's murder case. Some of you old enough will remember that O.J. Simpson was this great football player who then went on to be a television and movie personality and generally a well-liked celebrity. I wasn't doing a true crime story in the article. I just wanted to make a certain point that probability theory has something to say about an issue that came up in the case, which was that the prosecution wanted to introduce evidence that O.J. had previously beaten his wife, which there was really no dispute about that. She had made 911 calls to the police. She had photographs of her bruised face. People had seen him hitting her. So there was no dispute that O.J. Simpson was a wife batterer. But the question was, is that admissible and relevant in the murder trial? And the prosecution argued to the judge that it should be admitted because we know that when men murder their wives, they often had a history of beating them before that. So in that sense, it seems relevant. Whereas the defense said, no, you're getting the probabilities backwards. Men that beat their wives very rarely go on to murder them. In fact, in a given year, only 1 out of 2,000 batterers will murder their wife, which were the FBI crime statistics. So, you know, 1 in 2,000 is not a very great likelihood, and so it's not relevant. Alan Dershowitz for the defense said that's an infinitesimal, basically negligible probability that a batterer, it's not relevant, and so shouldn't be admitted in the case, and Judge Ito agreed with that. The jury never heard the evidence about OJ as a wife batterer. So the question is, from the standpoint of probability theory, what's the right way to think about all this information? And both the defense and the prosecution thought about it incorrectly. That's what's interesting. That the relevant way, the important point is not what either of them said. Here's the probability that you want to calculate. What's the probability that if a woman has been battered by her husband and is found murdered by someone, which are the two key facts about Nicole Brown Simpson, what's the probability that the batterer is the murderer? See, she was not just a random battered woman. She was a battered wife who was found dead in a bloody, grisly murder. And so in the article, I explain how with a little bit of probability theory, you can show that the odds are 9 out of 10 that the husband did it. I could do it right now with you in your head. It's so easy, okay? The murder rate for women in that year, sorry for you young children and parents. This is a very hard topic, but let's just think about it as a math problem for now. But it is important to understand this because these issues come up a lot in the legal system. I mean, this is showing how relevant math can be to the real world. That in 1994, the murder rate for women in the US was about 1 in 20,000 per year. So that means if you took a sample of 20,000 women, about one of them would be found murdered that year. So imagine a sample now of 20, and remember I said a minute ago that even the defense concedes that one out of 2,000 battered women will be murdered in a given year by her batterer. Okay, so now take a sample of 20,000 battered wives, like Nicole. Of those 20,000, one on average will be killed by a random person on the street. And since it's one out of 2,000 by the husband, and we're thinking of a sample of 20,000, 10 of them will be killed by their husband in that year. You follow me so far? Out of 20,000 battered women, on average, 10 will be killed by their abuser and one by someone else. Now, you've got 11 dead women, 10 of which were killed by their batterer. That's 10 out of 11 that the husband did it. Okay, and that leaves out bloody footprint evidence, DNA evidence. It also leaves the glove. It also leaves out the issue of whether Mark Furman planted the glove. I mean, there's a lot of other things we could talk about that might be either in favor of O.J.'s innocence. So I'm not talking about
that. Reasonable doubt, though, the same is beyond reasonable doubt.
I'm just mentioning that this 10 out of 11 might be considered not beyond a reasonable doubt. Right, I mean, often people say it should be less than 5% chance or even less than 1%. So you have to decide, a jury has to decide what's reasonable doubt. But I'm just, the question of whether it's relevant seems like it. Well, again, Judge Ito could decide, but he should be told that it's 90%. This is why the police usually think the husband did it. It's 90% chance that the battering husband did it. That doesn't prove that he did it. There may be, he may have an alibi. There could be a lot of reasons that he couldn't have done it. Anyway, I mention it not so much about the OJ case, which I see already is starting to provoke some discussion, as it did at the time. It's a very interesting and tricky case. But the point here is that the public was fascinated by this column, and it also was the number one emailed, and everybody, now it introduced some complicated Bayesian probability, which the average person has not studied, including the average, even math major in college may not have done this. Yet, the public is perfectly happy to do Bayesian probability if it's concrete enough and vivid enough. So my claim is you can do concrete and unfamiliar, or you can do abstract and familiar, but if you try to do abstract and unfamiliar, that is a tricky sell. That's hard. And I did try it once, and it's 8:30. If you'll indulge me, I just want to show you what a flaming wreck looks like. Piece on using a different principle, which was something that a mathematician had told me, and I thought it was a good idea. He said you should build an article around the visuals. You're on the web, you can do visuals, you can show movies, find a really good movie and then write the column around the movie. So I found a certain movie that I thought was really interesting, and let me set it up for you. This is about that geometry doesn't necessarily just live on the flat earth. We've been doing here tonight flat problems with circles and triangles, but as you know, the earth is not flat, and it's a globe, it's a spherical shape approximately, and there are interesting things about shortest paths on surfaces that aren't flat. Like if you're flying, here's New York City and here's Rome, and my dad used to love doing geography problems. He used to ask me, which is farther north, Rome or New York City? And most people assume New York is farther north because the weather is not as nice. But if you look on the globe, New York and Rome are really on the same latitude, very close. Rome is basically due east of New York to a good approximation. Yet, if you've ever taken that trip, the pilot does not fly due east. The pilot flies like I'm showing in the diagram, hugging the coast of Canada, and then over the Atlantic this way, and then past Ireland and into Rome. And as a kid, I thought this is for safety's sake, that you're trying to, like, we're gonna try to stay close to land as long as possible. And so we're going near Nova Scotia. Okay, we're near Newfoundland. If something goes wrong, we could go back. That's not right. It's the shortest path. If you hold up a globe and just look at it and look at where New York is, and then you just try to go as straight as you can go, realizing that you're on this curved shape, but don't do any additional curving. Don't go like that. You'll go as straight as you can go, respecting the curvature of the Earth. That's what the pilot does. Okay, so that's the generalization of a straight line. to a curved surface. Is go as straight as you can, just curving because of the curvature of the surface, but no additional curving. That's what in technical terms is called a geodesic. But don't worry about that. It's the straight line on a curved shape. So then I go in the rest of the article, I'm going to start showing you straight lines on curved shapes. So here we are doing straight lines on cylinders. That looks like what you'd expect. There's another straight line on a cylinder. It's in the shape of a helix. It doesn't look straight, but it is in a certain sense. I try to explain. Already people start getting unhappy. Then I say, you want me to explain that? Well, I'll get to it. It's a fair question. I don't want to take the time to do it right now. I'm sorry. Because I will sort of indirectly answer you. Here's some really cockamamie world that's shaped like a pretzel. It's got two holes. It's a torus, two-hole torus. So I'm showing the geodesics on a two-hole torus using these rubber bands. And so it's really getting abstract. It's very unfamiliar. And finally, this is what I was building the whole thing around, is this movie I want to show you of what a straight line looks like on this exotic two-hole torus that I thought, this was a cat's meow. I thought this was the greatest movie. I showed it to Carol, my wife. She said, this would appeal to a six-year-old boy, maybe, but nobody else. And this is really bad, and do not use this. And I said, no, I really think it's good. I think it's very interesting. And so here you can judge for yourself. I just tell you what you're seeing. That's supposed to be, you notice it's a motorcycle with no driver. The handlebars are locked straight ahead to simulate what I just said. Go as straight as you can go, no curving within the surface, only curving because of the surface. So if you do that, this is like making a robotic motorcycle that just drives straight ahead at all times, and then you watch what it looks like when it travels on this weird surface. That's a straight line on a two-hole torus. I thought that was great. Now, let's think of all the things that are terrible about this. First of all, what is that? That's movie, that's like the music they would use in a very bad pornographic movie. So that's no good. Then, the big problem is who cares? I tried to make readers care by gently going there. We're flying to Rome. It's nice in Rome. Now we're on a two-hole torus. Well. I couldn't pull it off. And so, in the end, the only people who liked it were the math geeks. And I was not writing for the math geeks. I was writing for everybody else. And one guy in the comments summed it up by saying, the series has now jumped the shark. No. Now, at the time, I didn't know what this phrase meant. Some of you, I guess, do know what it means. I looked it up. Ken, did you mention about Wikipedia is always right? Yeah, so I looked it up on Wikipedia, and it explained that in the old TV show Happy Days, the character Fonzie, who was a greaser and wore a leather jacket, the series needed some freshening up, and the writers felt like, well, what can we do? The series has gotten stale. Let's do something new. They have Fonzie in his leather jacket water skiing, jumping over a shark. And it had no point except to do something new, and so the term has come to mean whenever something that used to be good has gotten old, you jump the shark to keep the reader or the audience's interest. So I was being accused of jumping the shark, and it was only like the fifth or sixth column out of 15. And this was a serious concern. And it was just one reader. I could ignore him or her, but I took the criticism. I thought maybe it's right. Plus, the Carol kept saying, no, of course it's terrible. Why did you do that? So after that, I came to feel that from now on, I'm going to try to do what I said. That is, you can't do too much. You can be, like I say, you got to be either concrete or familiar. Otherwise, it's really going to be tough. So I guess with that, I should close. Thanks a lot for your participation and your attention.